Well, you join us on day 11, the Tokyo 2020 Olympic Games. This is the fifth day of the athletics here in the Olympic Stadium. And we are in for a treat with the women's long jump final, an event that's been long standing. The women's long jump was brought into the Olympic program back in London in 1948. Well, we've got 12 athletes that have made it through the qualifying 2 days ago. They've rested up and they'll be heading out shortly, ready to battle for the Olympic title in just a few minutes' time.
Yeah, I mean, typically in these field events, the qualifying in the past, World Championships and Olympics, has been on the previous day. And in this program in Tokyo 2020, they've changed things around a little bit. Now, the surface of this track is actually quite unforgiving. It's a very fast surface around the track, and obviously on the jumps, in particular high jump and long jump, pole vault. And what you get, you get a big return back into the foot contact. And what happens is, 2 days later, you're going to be a little stiffer than you were the day before. So it'll be fascinating to see, you know, how easy these long jumpers look, how they approach it, whether they get a good distance in to start the competition off, or whether they're just going to do a little bit of feeling around a little bit. And that will become evident as we start the competition and move through those first three rounds.
Well, you can just see the athletes, they've had their 30 minutes of warm-up, and they'll be leaving their kit out on the track as they head in, and they will be introduced to us one at a time. So all of their run-ups have been sorted. They've done any last-minute tweaks. And now it will be the time, the next time we see them, they will be ready for an Olympic final. Well, we've earlier had the men's triple jump qualification, but it is a morning session for this final, and we have some world-class athletes. As you would expect in an Olympic final, we've got the 2012 Olympic champion and Rio silver medalist, Brittney Reese. She's joined by her teammate, Tara Davis, both athletes jumping big this year with a 7.13 and a 7.14, respectively. But the biggest jump of the 12 who threw to this final actually came from Ese Brume, the Nigerian, who jumped 7.17 earlier in the year, and that was actually a personal best for the 25-year-old.
Now, if you're a long jump coach, and there's a population of coaches over there, one or two I recognise, they get older, but they, you know, they look familiar, is that they'll be looking for the win. They'll be trying just to see and assist there. Oh, and there you go.
As if you knew.
The production team is listening to me. And that little windsock over there has been, I've been watching it since I've been here quite earlier on this morning, and it's been moving to and fro. And in the triple jump qualifying, in two rounds that were running both pits, run-ups over earlier, we had a plus one and bits, and we had a -0.3, -0.4. So it's a typical large stadium that's got a roof partly over the seating at the top of the stadium. It's a wind just circles round, and it's a bit lucky. You can be lucky and you can get a tailwind, or you can be unlucky and you can get one just coming into your face.
Well, it's certainly a slim breeze up here, and you can see the athletes trying to cool themselves, sat down there in the heat that seems to sort of sit in the bottom of this bowl of the Olympic Stadium.
Well, the atmosphere for the event actually sort of been heightened by the presence of the coaches of the athletes that are jumping, but also there's quite a few competitors that are either waiting to compete towards the end of the week or have actually already competed, and they've come in and they've populated the seats and created quite a nice ambience, if you like, for the athletes as they get ready for their jumps.
Well, especially for the long jumpers, they are sat right down next to the track. A lovely view of the stadium. You can really see a breeze at the far end there with the Olympic flag flapping in the wind. And the athletes will certainly be hoping that that is 100% behind them when they hit the runway.
But who knows? The only people that know will be those athletes ready to go in. And you'll see them putting their hands out by the sides of their bodies, flicking their fingers, just seeing if they can feel any breeze coming from behind. But ultimately, they've got 1 minute to, you know, as soon as their name comes up on the board and it initiates that process, that automatic digital process, if you like, the name up, clock starts counting down, they've got a minute to complete and start their run. Technology at its best, isn't it? All those cameras automatically being pressed by somebody somewhere in the stands.
Well, they will be emitting some wonderful images, no doubt, from the long jump pit as we get ready for this world-class field. Well, the final for the women's long jump is just around the corner. Well, they're a very long-standing world record and Olympic record, both from 1988. A whopping 7:52 recorded all those years ago. And here we have our athletes. The first six, Tara Gittins, Brittney Reese, Brooke Stratton, Ivana Spanovic, Malaika Mihambo, Ese Brume, some big names in this top 12. Beck Romanchuk, Irizuru, Malone, Davis, Sawyers, Sagnia make up the 12. And now we'll get to introduce each athlete one at a time as they make their way into the stadium. Well, here comes our first onto the track. It is Tara Gittins who is enjoying every moment of this. The athlete from Trinidad and Tobago. She's a national record holder in the long jump as well as high jump and heptathlon. Apparently heptathlon her favorite event, but it's the long jump today.
Brittney Reese, USA, 35 next month. What a stalwart of the event she's been. Gold in London, silver in Rio, five world titles every year from 2009 to 2013.
Well, Brooke Stratton representing Australia, her third Olympic final. She finished sixth in London, seventh in Rio. Can she go a little further up the rankings, having won the silver at the Commonwealth Games?
Ivana Spanovic from Serbia, third in Rio. She also has two world championship bronzes, and she was the leading qualifier, just getting a season's best of 7 meters.
Malaika Mihambo representing Germany, the reigning world champion, fourth in Rio. Can she get to the top step in the final here in Tokyo?
Jumping at six from Nigeria, the reigning African.
The Nigerian Ese Brume of Nigeria. Now, she was fifth in Rio. This event, by the way, is littered with athletes from Rio, as we'll see when we get into the competition.
Well, Mariana Beck Romanchuk, very experienced silver medalist at the World Championship 2 years ago in Doha. However, in Rio, she didn't register a jump in the final. She'll be wanting to put that behind her today.
Abigail is Irozo Zuru of Great Britain, 31-year-old. She's got into finals. She's never threatened the medals, but she's come seventh at a couple of major championships, and she'll be looking to get closer to those medals in this competition.
Chantal Malone looking relaxed, the Pan American Games champion from 2019. She did take three jumps to qualify, but she's through to the final, starting on a fresh slate.
Tara Davis, 7:14 this year, 6:85 in qualifying, one of the automatic qualifiers, and she is coming out and she's confident, cheeky, and we can't wait to see how this University of Texas athlete performs today.
Well, Jasmine Sawyers, the second of the two British women in this final, full of energy, former gymnast, went to bobsleigh, but now back to the long jump. This is her second long jump Olympic final.
And to complete the 12th up to jump in the final is Kadi Sagnia of Sweden. 6:72 best this year. Got a best of 6:78 from 2015. Qualified automatically with a jump of 6:76. And that gives us the 12 contenders for the women's long jump final.
Well, you can see the cone being removed as the first athlete Tyra Gittins is already on the run-up, getting ready for her first jump. These first jumps can be so nerve-wracking, just trying to get a good score, get a clean jump on the board.
Gittins' first jump in this women's long jump final. On the board, sounded like it, didn't it?
Certainly did. The white flag, always good to get a clean jump to start, but her face does not show too much impressed with that performance.
Well, when they're introduced to the crowd through that archway, they're sort of dancing around the place, but now the business face is on, and we're just waiting for that distance to come up. Not a bad opener, but a nervy opener, I think would be the best description. 6 meters 30 in a zero wind. That's an important thing, that little figure under that distance, 0.0 meters per second, absolutely still.
Well, I'm sure she'll just be relieved of some of those nerves to have got that first jump out, jumping first. It's not very long from when they get introduced to the crowd before they jump, but this woman has had plenty of experience at this top level. Second to jump, Brittney Reese, the Olympic champion from London 2012. Well, that looked an impressive start.
Well, she'll be pleased that she's hit the board, or just off the board. She almost looks sort of slovenly. I'm not being rude here, just sort of her action looks too relaxed for me, but that's how she does things, and she's got springs. Yeah, she's off the board, she's short of that, so you could add 24 onto what she's jumped if she can hit the board, but she is very springy. She's got fantastic jumping capacity in those two legs, and you can see 660 with 20-odd centimetres lost on the board, that's 680. So she'll be relaxed, more relaxed now, and she'll be a contender, believe you me.
She certainly will be. Well, here's another contender at her third Olympic Games, Brooke Stratton. Used to performing under pressure, was the evidence of the Rio final on the inside of her wrist. Well, she's made the final every time.
Very long run-up. You'll see her starting in the pit at the other end, that extension of the run-up. We're looking for sort of efficient speed. And it's a no jump. She's gone on to the plasticine. But you're looking to accelerate into the board, then just prepare for takeoff by just dropping the hips on that takeoff for a fraction. You don't want to go too far because you just stick on the board. What you're looking for is almost to continue running at that takeoff point. And your head's got to be up, the posture's got to be right over your feet, all those technical things, they work for months and months and years and years and years.
Ivana Spanovic, she is an athlete who will be desperate to secure the white flag early on. Bronze medalist from Rio. She can perform at the highest of levels, as all of these athletes can. What could she bring out on her first jump?
Well, she'll take the lead with that one. Just looked a little stiff on the runway, if you like, for me. 7 meters in qualifying was very smooth once she got warmed up and got into the flow. Good speed. You can see standing and running right over those feet as she comes into the takeoff area. On the board, reasonably well. Good block on that takeoff foot and then carries on running. And that leg shoot into the sandpit. She'll take an early lead, 6.71 for Spanovic.
Well, all of these jumps at the moment well within the athlete's abilities of the first three, but here we have one of the favourites, if not the favourite, Malaika Mihambo from Germany. She finished agonisingly close to the podium 5 years ago. And she set down an impressive starter mark.
Well, it's almost one of those situations where you jump that and I'm going to jump a little further. Mihambo looking very good on the runway. Good start. It's nice and precise. High knee running action. Those arms pumping away. And then that takeoff, that continuation of the running at the takeoff board. 16 centimetres, you'd want them to be on the board a little bit more accurately. but they're just feeling this runway. It's firm, it's fast, and you've just got to get some of those runway runs into your legs. 6.83, she takes the lead from Spanovic in this early stages of the women's long jump final.
Well, she's looking very relaxed, not wasting any energy on extra emotions there and going through the process that she will have done. Time in, time out, and a little smile shows she'll be happy to have taken the pressure off with that first jump.
Absolutely, and you know, it is very... It's the Olympic final. They have been here before, but it's a new Olympic final, and now we have the Nigerian coming up for her first jump.
Ese Brume took three jumps to qualify to make it through to this final. She will have taken experience from those three, no doubt, of the track, of the environment in this Olympic stadium.
Well, that could be another lead. So we've gone Spanovic 671, Mihambo 683, and now we've gone Brume just going a little bit further. Nice on the runway. Look at these pumping arms, those legs, those feet, just right underneath in terms of posture, coming fast onto the board. And you've got to say that's the best on the board so far, as she gets that takeoff foot right on, looking down, those wide eyes. What a shot that is. Leg shoot out. Just under 7 meters is my interpretation. Look at that, 6.97 for the Nigerian.
Well, that is a significant increase on her qualification jump, over 20 centimeters further. So she's got to be happy with that. She's actually jumped the furthest of all of these jumpers this year. Well, next up, Mariana Beck-Romanchuk. She got fouled out in Rio in the final. She didn't actually secure a jump from these first three opportunities. I'm sure she has put that behind her. This will be an important moment, and it was not a good start for the Ukrainian.
Well, I think we'll see from the replay that she put that takeoff foot well in past the plasticine, almost heavily strapped on that takeoff knee, or the takeoff leg, the knee of her takeoff foot, 9 centimeters over there. And that means that she's got a bit of an niggle, but it's supportive tape as opposed to reconstruction tape, is what I call it. It's just keeping things nice and tight around that knee joint. But she'll go red, and this is technology these days. You can film it and you can review it. I'm not sure that's allowed, but I'm sure the officials will put him straight if it isn't.
Well, she'll be seriously wanting to get that second jump underway after that nightmare she had in Rio when not actually registering a jump. So that's got to be playing on her mind.
You would hope not, and you would have practiced a little bit to say it wasn't, but the fact you've heightened it means that it's probably going to be on your mind.
Well, next to jump, Abigail Irizarry. She had a strong jump, improved actually on each jump in the qualifiers.
Well, she gets a red flag, but actually, if she did a leg shoot and kept her feet together, you'd see that she'd be close to that 7 meter line. A little untidy in the air, but that's probably created because the foot has gone on to the plasticine. So she knows as she takes off that she's saying to herself in the air, blast. I felt the plasticine and I'm not going to really tighten up on my landing gear. Aston Moore in the crowd there, the British coach. Working with this young lady. And it's hot out there.
Chantal Malone getting ready for her attempt number one. Won the Pan American Championships 2 years ago, but this is most certainly the highest level of competition, making it through to an Olympic final for the first time. Took three jumps to qualify. Is she going to need that warm-up again now in the final?
Well, I always think that when you have a run-up that sort of is a little bit fluid and not tight in terms of where that start-off foot that initiates the run is putting you at risk. And you see here she has to shorten strides to make sure that she gets onto the board. Now she does that, and she's nicely onto the board, but she's compromised the speed and the accumulative acceleration that you need to really hit that board and take off positively and get a better jump. But it's still not bad, 6.50 with a plus 0.5 wind. So there's a bit of a breeze blowing up over at the long jump area.
Well, we'll be hoping that breeze increases when they come. And now look at the smile on Tara Davis. She has come out onto this track full of energy. Can she convert that energy into distance in the sandpit? Just loving every moment here, this Olympic experience. Only 22 years of age, her first Olympic Games, and she is getting the support of the crowd that are actually down next to the long jump area, the fellow athletes, coaches, and even the fellow competitors. They're trying.
They're a family. Jumpers tend to be very sort of gregarious, outward looking, outward going. And she's off for her first jump in this women's final of the long jump. Well, it's not a bad effort, but again, a bit of deceleration into the board as she sort of just put the radar up to check that the takeoff foot was going to be in the right sort of area. Good running style, nice and fast, and then just on the board, just touching it with the front of her spikes, 17 centimeters short. A good jump, and if you add 12 of those 17 onto the jump at the end, then you've certainly got something that's going to be competitive. So 6.62 for Tara Davis in the first round.
Puts her into fourth, and I think she's someone who's going to rise to the occasion. Looks like she is going to embrace this final and raise her game.
And as we go through, it's a process of just controlling the emotions on one hand, getting the feel of the track, checking out the wind. There's a lot of things going on as these women sort of prepare to get their early jumps in. And you're looking for a good positive result in those early rounds because you've got to make the cut. You've got to get to the top eight.
Jasmine Sawyer's going through her mental process as she strides down the runway for her first attempt.
Well, she gets the red flag, but that must have been quite close. My perception was that we heard the board come into contact with the foot, but she's 9 centimetres over. She'll have to make some adjustments on that runway. Very fast on the runway, Sawyers. Very positive in her outlook in terms of approaching that board. But sadly, she puts a foul out, and it was in the pit. It was sort of around 7 metres, so it would have been a good jump. So they'll be talking about the adjustments, how much, the adjustments that you need to make. Now, bizarrely in long jump, if you want to make sure that you get your foot down on the board, there's almost a sense that you've got to take your run up in a fraction, if that makes sense. So she just wants to be tighter in that takeoff area. And if you are too far out, then you overstretch to reach the board, and you almost want to make sure that the board comes towards you in this event.
Beck Romanchuk making sure she just stays relaxed. But now it is Kari Sagnia from Sweden on her first attempt. Well, she's got the white flag that she would have been hoping for. It'll be a recorded jump, and that's always going to just help take the nerves away.
It certainly is. And, you know, almost sanguine on the runway in terms of speed. The perceptions, it doesn't look as fast as Sawyers, for example, but nice and controlled. Head stays up, which is always a positive sign, and that just gives you space to get those get that leg shoot in. She actually was a youth champion at triple jump, and she didn't qualify for the final in Rio. So she's had a bit of experience, 27-year-old, and she'll want to be putting that performance from Rio back into context and get to the final eight in this in Tokyo 2020.
Well, just six have jumped, six to go. Sorry, four left to jump. We'll to get on the board with a score. Well, here we go for her second attempt. Tyra Gittens, 6:30, her best so far.
Bit of shuffling on the runway. It's the last thing you want as you're coming in at speed, where you, Jen, have to just adjust your approach. She did it actually pretty well, so she's obviously practiced the art of just shortening strides and then trying to elongate that last stride. Gets on the board, so the radar's working. It's just that you lose so much of that approach speed.
Well, considering she's still, I think, improved on her previous performance.
No, she's in good shape in terms of the event. She's improved to 660 with a minus wind. She just needs to be smoother and flow more on that run-up. She could go long.
Well, certainly moving in the right direction for Gittens. Ivana Spanovic. Spotlight will be on her in a couple of jumps' time. But right now, it is Brittney Reese, one of the most decorated long jumpers, going for her third Olympic medal. She just looks so relaxed, doesn't she?
Well, that could be the best jump so far in this competition. Reese getting her action together. A little tighter on that runway, good. Better on the board if she did get onto the board. So relaxed on the runway. It's almost as if she needs a prod to make her wake up and go for it. But such fantastic springs. And yes, on the board this time, and that makes the difference. Sets her up for that takeoff foot. Good springs in that takeoff leg. And she shoots out into the pit. Look, those 2 feet staying together. Just falls back a little bit on her shoulders there. But 6.81 up into third for Reese Brittney. Brittney Reese. Which way round is it?
There's Brittney Reese. Well, she managed 6.86 in her qualifier, so she's still going to be warming up into it. Has got a personal best of 7.31, which helped her win that title back in London. Brooke Stratton. Her personal best of 7.05. She has been quite a long way off that, 6.60 in her qualification. Looking for the white flag on this second attempt.
And you will see them just sort of delay their run-up. And that was a minus 1.2 wind that Reese was running into.
Looks good on the board.
Stratton with that long run-up coming from the other pit at the other end. She holds the speed at takeoff. Good on the takeoff board. But if you compare the springs that you see in Reese when she takes off and Stratton, you can see that there's a different bounciness about the ability to take off on that board.
Well, she'll be relieved to have a score on the board after that first no jump. So 6.52, putting her currently in eighth.
And if she stays in eighth, she'll be delighted, believe you me, because that will give her another 3 jumps.
Ivana Spanovic, a 6.71 already. Wanting to build on that as she goes through this competition. She was the longest jumper in qualification, the only one to actually hit 7 metres. 7 metres dead in the qualification.
And I think that is going to be very close to 7 metres. That graphic with that white line that we can see on the screen is indicating the 7 metre mark. It's not in the sand. The jumpers don't know that's there. However, seems to just overstride, but it settles her down to a very good cadence on the runway. And she's pretty good on the board, splitting it in half, which is perfect. You're not compromising the plasticine at all from there. Just sort of a bit of twist in the air, the hips. But generally speaking, a very, very tidy jump. And good at takeoff. That's the key issue, and that's what they'll be talking about. There you go, he's doing it with his hands, but he's talking about that takeoff. 6.91 for Spanovic.
Well, putting her into second place at this early stage. Brume, one who is still at the top after her opener of 6.97. Malaika Mihambo in third after her opener. Can she start to put pressure on those jumpers at the top? She's got the ability.
Tall, athletic, like a sprint start on that runway. I like that, it's fixed. The first step is going to be within reason in the same place. Second step follows, you just get, build up that cadence into the takeoff zone. Great running style from below. Those arms are a little untidy, but the legs are functioning perfectly well. And just clipping, well, good on takeoff. That's really important. You want wood on that takeoff foot, because you're just going to get a better response from it rather than certainly plastic and all the track. 6.95, Mihambo. So things are starting to warm up nicely in the women's long jump final.
They certainly are. We're getting close to the 7 meters, which I'm sure it's going to take a jump bigger than seven to win this competition, with Ese Brume on 6.97, leading the competition. Great first jump by the Nigerian. Just 2 centimetres ahead of Mihambo, who seems to be getting into her stride. So can Ese Brume build on that opener? Can she be the first one to go over 7 metres in this women's long jump final? The biggest jump in the field this year. She deliver it when it counts.
I've got a twitching co-commentator here who's taking off at the same time. Now, again, you can see the run-up is fundamental to being comfortable at that takeoff point. And it just shortens in on those last 2 or 3 strides, and it just sets up a rotation in the upper body forwards, and then you go past that takeoff foot by fraction. We're talking fractions here. And then you've got to put it right in the air. And it's a balancing act between speed, takeoff pressure on the board, and all that sort of stuff. And you can't afford to shorten the strides too much as you come to that takeoff point.
Well, a little shake of the head from the coach. That's actually 30 centimetres less than her opener. She's taken the pressure off herself with that strong first jump. And maybe just trying something a little bit, pushing it a little bit too hard.
Well, again, yeah, the temptation is to try run on too fast and then lose your stride and lose what you're used to accommodating. And I was just trying to work out there, actually, who twitched the most, her coach or you?
Nerve-wracking stuff watching this final. And this woman, Marina Beck-Womanchuk, will be absolutely set on getting the white flag. She had a no jump the first time. She qualified on her first jump 2 days ago with a 6.71. That's all she needs, just to get herself into the competition now. Could we be seeing a repeat of that nightmare she had in Rio 5 years ago, when she had 3 red flags? She's put herself under pressure.
Well, she has, and that's just, you know, just the tip of the toe ducking into that plasticine. She's quite nice on the runway. That tape would worry me. It's a takeoff foot, and the knee is obviously not happy, and a bit of frustration in the coach's seats. But if you're not quite flowing easily and your nerves are sort of flying around and they can't be controlled, this is what the Olympic Games and this is what finals are all about. Who can put the butterflies together? Who can think positively about what they're going to do? And at some point, you know, too much information can be too much for anybody, let alone an athlete trying to compete in an Olympic Games final.
Abigail, Irozuru on her second attempt. That looked better on the board.
Much better on the board. Good speed into that takeoff area on that board. Held it up, stayed nice and tall on the hips, using those long legs to good effect into the takeoff ball. Good height off the board. Still a little untidy in the leg shoot where there's a little bit of rotation, but spot on the board, and she'll take some confidence for that into her third attempt, which is going to be really important because she sits in ninth position at the moment with 651.
Well, relieved to have a jump on the board, but it won't be enough, like you say, if she can't improve this next time around. Well, she'll still be delighted to be competing at Olympic Games, having retired after Rio and then came back. Well, this lady still in the lead at the moment. Disappointing second jump, but that won't worry her. Chantelle Malone preparing for her second attempt. 6:50, her opener, which also puts her outside of that all-important top eight at this early stage. We saw a lot of adjustment on the first jump and that run-up just not working for Malone.
And you can see here that perhaps not a lack of experience in terms of her jumping ability, but just perhaps a lack of experience and not having enough of these run, this particular surface in the legs, and just losing the flow and the rhythm quite early on in the run-up. It's almost, she's not carrying an injury, or it doesn't appear to be. So it's just that inability of the legs to take the hits of these foot contacts on this surface at this moment in time.
Well, she did take three jumps to qualify, but then qualified quite convincingly with a 6.82. So she knows she can do it.
And she'll be reflecting on that, I'm pretty certain, before she takes her third and final attempt.
Tara Davis, with all that energy, she had a convincing first jump, looks very comfortable. So she's taken the pressure off herself for that. But now let's see if the young American can really show her potential. Focus on that face. She gets into her rhythm. Even springs up out of the sand. She's got so much energy.
She's got the benefit of youth on her side. There's Tara Davis. Nice speed on the runway, nice running action. Good, ran into the board, carried on running. Just not the timing, just probably not quite right. But if she does that again and hits the board on a third attempt, then we could see a good distance achieved by the American. 667, slight improvement. She holds fifth place at the moment as we go into the closing stages of this second round in the women's final, long jump final.
Well, this is where the pressure will start to be put on those who are outside of the top eight. First three jumps, and then we will lose four of the jumpers. Jasmine Sawyers, one of those who might be feeling the pressure. She hasn't yet recorded a score on her first jump.
Well, let's hope that's put the record board straight. Sawyers, really good on the runway. Carried on sprinting, if anything, perhaps just overstride in the last stride, just to make sure she got that takeoff foot on the board. There, great on the right foot takeoff, just short of 7 meters, and that will give her a massive amount of confidence as we move through this competition.
Well, it really will, and she has had plenty of experience, a 6.80 for Sawyers, and that's surely going to put her in a good position going into the third jump. Better than her qualifying jump, 6.90, her personal best, which she actually did this season, so not far shy of that.
No, that's a really good jump, and she's a sort of performer that will benefit from having that under her belt and jumping that far. So She's got a great chance now to progress up the board.
Buddy Sagnia, 6.58. She needs to better that to keep herself in a safe position in this final.
Well, it could be a slight improvement. In the air, it's just rotating around. You can see her almost like a wriggly worm in the air, you know, turning around that hip. But that's the trick of fantastic long jump. And you've got to have all these skills. You've got to have speed into the takeoff zone. At takeoff, you've got to be strong and stand tall. And then those abdomen muscles have got to tighten everything in to keep everything in line so the legs can then shoot out as far as they can into the pit. And that's a better attempt, certainly, for Sagnia of Sweden. 6.67. And she sits in seventh place as we go into the third round of this women's long jump final.
Well, still no change at the top from that first jump at Ese Brume. But this is the important, or the nervous end of the draw, especially for Marina Beck-Romanchuk.
Well, they look pretty chilled, don't they? But just reflecting on the men's long jump, which was won in the last round. And interestingly, the jumps that you have in the competition are really important because it goes to count back like it did in the men's. You want a good jump to back up what you've done best.
Well, Gittins with a best of 6.60. Doesn't look like she's managed to improve much on that, if at all.
And she's been pushed down into that nervy eighth position in the final as we go into this third round. And she's first up, so she's now got a sit. If that's not better than her best so far, 6.60, which is waiting for the, and it looks like it might not be, again, cut the stride, try to accelerate by shortening the stride, then that's a bit of false feeling of speed. Got on the board nicely, but again, that sort of loss of shape in the air, and the feet come down slightly sooner than she wanted them to into the pit. And we're just waiting. No, slightly best. So, yes, very nervous times for Gittins as she sits in eighth. Anybody goes over 6.60 that's below her will take her place.
Well, she can do nothing about it now other than relax and hope that she gets a fourth jump. This woman looking safe, Brittney Reese, the 6.81, putting her in a very good starting position. And now it's time to see what the experience of Reese. Are we going to see something impressive here?
That could be the first one over seven. On the run-up, she almost looks she's hunting something. You know, it's like she's going to be chasing you down. That's what it looks like.
She looks so relaxed in the air, though, and that's the difference you can really notice. It sort of seems so smooth.
Well, it's really relaxed in her running style. You know, if you cut her off above her hips, her arms are just using her to keep her balance. Good leg shoot, great on the board. Though all those years of experience, all those medals, those five world championships, three medals, silver in Rio, and then two golds. So she's going for four medals here, and look at that, 6.97.
Well, we're still just shy of seven. That puts her on top equal with Ese Brume, who I think is jumping up next, or the next but one. It'll be interesting to see how Broom reacts to that, but a good increase by...
And crucially, she's got that second round jump of 6.81, so she's got backup. So she's got a good jump now backing up that. And if it stays like this, there's only one winner going to be called.
Well, I'm sure we're going to see them push closer to the seven, but it's a 6.52, the best so far for Brooke Stratton, her third attempt. We'll wait to see the flag. It was a white. It looked like a close one. Was that an improvement on the 6.52? She needs it to be if she's going to stay in this final. Gittins waiting nervously.
It's going to be close, but I think it's the clenched fist. So, yep, 6.83. It wasn't close at all. She sailed over and she's moved up the board to fifth position now overall with that jump of 6.83 meters. Interestingly, as we watch the replay, a wind of plus 1.2 seconds, so the wind is getting up, and blimey, how close can you get to the plasticine?
Well, she'll
you can't
be
get closer.
You can't. She'll be delighted to have got that jump in when she needed it, and it actually puts Gittins out of the top eight. Spanovic now. 6.91. She went 7.2 days ago. She is right up there pushing those at the top in fourth, coming into this third jump.
Well, it's peppering that 7 meter line, isn't it? She seemed to just cut a stride into takeoff then. It's almost as if she overstrode it too much in the early stages of her run. It's very well constructed, obviously very well practiced. And you can see here every sinew in those lower limbs getting her towards that board. Great on takeoff. You can't be more efficient than that. Good leg shoot, although you just want a little bit more height so you can express that leg shoot a little bit more. 684. Good backup jump to that 691.
Well, consistent by the Serbian. She'll take confidence from that as we progress through this competition. Malaika Mihambo currently sitting in third with that 6.95. She's just 2 centimeters shy of the joint leaders. We know she has got a bigger jump in her. She's been building. Second jump, a nice increase.
And the wind here, you know, she had a plus 1.3 in the first round and then it went down to plus 0.6 in the second. So the wind is generally behind and it's moving from plus one to less than plus one.
Well, far off the Plasticine there, and that didn't help her efforts for that third jump.
My feeling is she just needs to relax in the running a little. You can almost see her shoulders up too high and her arms are pumping away and the legs are trying to keep up with the arms. Just needs to take a breath. Off the board, 20 centimeters down off the Plasticine, and we'll see what the distance is, but it's not shoddy. It's a good jump by 6.78, so that would have taken her very close to 7 meters, wouldn't it?
Yeah, she'll know that. She'll take the confidence from it. It is her shortest jump of the three, but just keeping the consistency, I reckon we're gonna see something impressive in the next few jumps from the German. Well, Ese Brume equal at the top. Brittney Reese equalizing with her third jump. How is Brume going to react to that? Getting a bit of crowd support. She's been pushing the field at the top of this competition since the start. Fifth at the Rio Olympics. She's had 5 years more of training, 5 years more experience, and it's starting to show. It doesn't look like she, even if it was a white flag, wouldn't have improved on her opener.
Well, the wind is playing tricks, and I think she's just indicating to the coach that, you know, suddenly she felt as if she'd got a bit more speed than she needed as she approached. And it's fine margins, yes, 2.8 centimeters, just an inch into the Plasticine. And when you think that they're running in from 30, 35 meters back, cut the stride to try and get, desperately trying to get it, but it, you know, it was on the 7 meter mark. So she's in good shape. She's in second, same as Reese, but on count back, she's in silver medal position as we go halfway through this third round.
Well, I would not want to be in the shoes of Marina Beck-Romanchuk. She hasn't found her groove yet, and this is her last chance to score or to get the white flag and to get on the board, and she's got to jump over 6.67 to make it through the next stage.
Well, that's the way you do it. Bit of pressure. What's pressure?
Well, she rose to that occasion, didn't she? She's got to feel a little relieved at that, I think, and now her competition can really begin.
Well, the Ukrainian, but I mean, bizarrely, you know, you say just begin, but she may be so relieved that she loses the tension that's helped to get out to 6.88 with a plus 0.4 wind behind her. and the coach shows her what it looked like. Good speed on the runway. Not dissimilar to Spanovic in terms of the mechanics of the running action. 7 point good on the board, and that's crucial. She'd missed, the radar was off in the first two attempts, and she benefits from that tightness. Off takeoff, and out she goes to 6.88. So whoever was in eighth is now in ninth.
Well, it really is starting to put pressure on those lower position jumpers, isn't it? But these four sitting nervously in those positions with Irizarry under pressure herself. She's got to get a big jump. And you can see the eight line there, quite clear of where Irizarry needed to reach, and that is not going to be enough for the Brit.
Well, the first part of the equation is the white flag. She wasted that first jump with a no jump. She just doesn't look as fast as some of the other jumpers in this competition, but she's got good springs, good takeoff, but miles, so 34 centimeters off the board. Some issues with the accuracy of that takeoff foot. And if you were to add 34 centimeters to 627, it probably still wouldn't be enough, but it'd be slightly better. 651 for the British athlete. And she's going to finish down in 11th at this moment in time as we come towards the conclusion of the third round of the women's long jump final.
We see the two Americans, competitors and teammates. But when it comes to the runway, it's just you that you will be thinking about. And in between, doing their best to stay cool and relaxed, as cool as you can stay in the heat of this Olympic stadium. Chantal Malone in 12th place. She's going to have to produce something very special to stay in this final. A 6.67 or better is what's required.
Well, actually, the graphics, these clever graphics people have put a line there for eighth position now. You can see two white lines. The first one is the current eighth position. Compromise the run-up speed by shorting a stride here just to get that takeoff foot onto the board. It wasn't worth doing because she's missed the board, fallen short on the board. And that causes all sorts of knock-on effects then to as you take off and get into the air.
Well, she's never looked comfortable, has she? All three of her jumps. I mean, the second one obviously was a bit of a no jump, but she managed a 6.82 in the qualifiers. Not able to perform today under this pressure. Well, Tara Davis has been consistent in the 6.60s, but she's under a little bit of pressure now, sitting in eighth. Only a few left to jump, but she'll still want to just put herself in a slightly more comfortable position as we head into the pointy end of the competition.
Much better from Davis. Well, much more positive on the runway, had intent. You could see she's deliberately started to put some burners in those feet to get going quicker, and she was able to convert that into the vertical because she got on the board with that takeoff foot, converted that to horizontal speed at takeoff and out to 6.81, and puts her in seventh place at the moment. And Jasmine Sawyers, whose next jump is sitting in eighth position with 6.80 meters.
Well, it'll come down to the jumper after her. Cardi Sagnio will be the only one that could put Sawyers out if Sawyers doesn't improve on this 6.80. But that was a great jump in the previous round. Can she build on that? She's close to her personal best, 6.90, and that was this year. So she's obviously in good form.
Just looked as though she shortened the stride just that too much. A little bit too much in terms of preparing to take off. Good speed at this stage of the runway. Nice posture. Just see, just tightened up as she came into the final two or three strides and just clips the board. Yeah, the face says it all. Yeah, the effort that has to go into that conversion of horizontal to vertical with that block of the foot hitting the board, shooting you up into the sky. 6.53. She'll be very nervous now as the final jump in the third round. Sagnier comes on to the runway. She needs 6.80.
Well, Sagnier's biggest jump, 6.67 on the last. That was an improvement from her opener. But in qualifier, she only managed a 6.76, so she's going to have to do her biggest jump of the Olympic Games if she's going to make it through to the top eight. Can she deliver under this pressured moment? Well, even if it's a white flag, you can see, which it is, you could see from that graphic, we'll wait for the confirmation, but it doesn't look like Sagnier has done enough, and that will mean that Sawyers will get to jump again.
Well, not only that, but she'll be first up in the, once they've sorted out the numbers, Sawyers will be, so 6.58 for Sagnier, 6.67 was her best champ, so she'll be out of the competition at this stage. She finishes ninth, just outside the top eight. It's always a horrible, horrible position to be in when, and you'll be playing in your mind about what if I should have, whatever, should have, could have, would have, or whatever those phrases are. But she'll be leaving the competition. Four of the athletes will go from the long jump area, and it'll be a quick shuffle now. We reverse the order. So Sawyers, who's in eighth, will go first, and Reese, who is in first, by virtue of count back, will go last. And you can see that. Two on 6.97, count back in operation as we speak.
Well, those top two athletes and Mihambo as well knocking on the door of 7 meters. Are we going to see anything in that region? A lot of these athletes have soared past the 7 meter mark this year. Mihambo managed the season's best in qualifier, but she does have a personal best of 7.30. So well short of her best at the moment. But Broome, you just spotted there for a moment, she's got the biggest jump of the year with a 7.17. So well below the potential of these athletes, for some of them at least. Are they going to raise their game as we move into the final three jumps?
Well, now the temptation is to try too hard, go too fast on the runway, just put things in place which aren't the norm. Or just turning up it a little bit, managing the process, just chipping away and staying in the competition. Or are we going to see somebody go really long? And that can happen in the long jump. Somebody just has that moment of brilliance and off they go, huge leg shoot, and in the pit over 7 meters. And I've got a feeling we're going to get a 7 meter throw here. There's two of them peppering the 7 meter line, and then there's two or three just behind that.
Well, there's certainly ability and class in this field. And this year, we've actually had 5 of these athletes equal or better 7 meters. So you would expect to see that 7 meter mark soon get smashed and potential changes at the top. But some of these athletes have been proven. I mean, Brittney Reese, for example, she is currently in that top position, and she has been proven to raise her game when she needs to.
Well, and I've just looked at, we mentioned earlier that 7 of these women were in the final 8 in Rio, and guess what? You got 7, the same 7 contesting the top 8. The intruder into the competition is Tara Davis, who's 22 years of age, and 5 years ago, she was just trying to get on the exciting journey of long jumping around the world. Yeah, how amazing is that? In 2 Olympic cycles, and not only 2, but 5 years difference in years terms, the 2020 Games has got 7 of the same 8 from Rio.
That is quite unusual. I don't know how many other sports will have the same, but it is Sawyers who is in 8th position, so first to jump.
Well, she is a bundle of energy at takeoff. You know, it's just like a blur. It's like a power ball, putting the foot on the board and then getting up. Conversion up, great height off the takeoff foot. good speed, and then that sort of that secret formula of conversion of horizontal speed into vertical takeoff height. And Sawyer has got that in bundles. 674, so it's a good backup jump to that 680.
Well, really consistent by the Brit. I mean, her best this year, 690, and that is her personal best. So it just shows that she's being just really, really consistent. She's got it dialed in. She's found the rhythm. So we could see something even bigger from her.
Well, let's hope so. She's certainly in a nice rhythm on this run-up. And you have to say the ambient temperature is helping these athletes. It's fantastically warm. It's perfect for the power events. And they're taking advantage of it.
Well, in seventh place, but she has improved continuously. Each jump increased in distance, Tara Davis. 681, her third. Can she continue in the same direction with this attempt? Well, it looks like it might be close to her previous or bettering. Not quite.
Well, you've got to say, you've got to say that the feet were very good, but then you'll just see, is it an elbow or a hand? Come back on this right hand at this side. I know it was her left elbow, so she rotated, and it was her left elbow that went in the sand below that graphic, that 7 meter white line that we can see that isn't in the pit. And she just rotated round on landing, and that left elbow, look, there, goes back. I'm pretty certain it was the left elbow. Slight improvement,
well,
though.
Well, look at this. She, at just 22 years of age, is rising to this occasion. Jumping further each time. She's got two more. How much more can she improve? Well, she's moved up one place from that, just ahead of Brooke Stratton. So Stratton finds herself in seventh. She finished seventh at the last Olympics in Rio, sixth in London. Very long run up.
If it was me, I'd get tired, and I think she did too on that one. You just see a general deceleration as she comes into the takeoff zone. Good speed there, but then it just sort of just slows down a little bit. No space to get the legs up. No conversion that we've been talking about of that speed off the runway into height.
Well, she's going to need more than that if she's going to improve on her best Olympic position. She's still in seventh place after her fourth attempt.
Coach. These coaches, it's a bit like the commentary position. How many different ways can you say good run-up speed, conversion of this to that, great takeoff, loss of control of the hips, or shortening of the stride? And the coaches in the stand will be saying the same thing. Come on, get your run up sorted, for goodness sake.
Well, let's see if Beck Romanchak can find her groove. She did a 688 and her only recorded jump. It was big. Has she now relaxed into it? Are we going to see something special? Well, she struggled on those first two to get her foot placement correct, and she's got frustration.
Well, it's a frustrating game, isn't it? No matter what sport you do, you're going to have moments when things click, and then you're going to have probably 100 times moments when they don't click. That's what sport is all about, that finding that moment where everything goes for you. Into the Pleistocene, she would have known that, and you could see on the landing that it's just sort of like a forlorn effort to try and even recover in the air. I mean, you have to take off. You've got there, but you could see that no leg shoot.
Yeah, she's aiming big and she's just not quite getting her foot down in time. But when she does, she's a threat to the top player. She still sits in fifth.
Yeah, going back to the Ukrainian, 679, that's personal best 68. Not personal best, season's best of 688.
Well, just shy of the medal positions at the moment. Spanovic with a 691. In her second attempt.
Well, it's like the old adage, if we measured no jump for Spanovic on her fourth attempt, but you can see she's not far off. She's very, very well disciplined on the runway. generates the right sort of speed, but it's just taken out too close into that plasticine. You can see she compromised. She shortened those strides into takeoff and then looked as though she went over 70, but left back, but it's in the plasticine. No jump for Spanovic.
Well, she stays in fourth place. She was bronze medalist 5 years ago. I'll be hoping to at least equal that, but she needs to pull out something special, as these three next to jump have been doing so. Malaika Mihambo, 6.95 so far, putting her just 2 centimetres behind the leaders. She is the reigning world champion. She can jump 7.30. Can she bring her game to the Olympic Games? Great to see her fellow competitors, Brittney Reese, giving the clap as well, sitting nervously just 2 centimetres longer than Mihambo. Well, realised that had gone totally wrong and not wasting the energy.
Well, you know, they practice run-ups and jump so many times into a sandpit that I guess you're going to know when things aren't quite right. Mihambo felt that that wasn't going to end up in the right place, probably 10 to 15 metres out from the takeoff board.
Well, save the energy. She's got 2 jumps left. She sits in that bronze medal position, so close to the leaders. Ese Brume equaling the longest jump of the day, but like you said earlier, Brittney Reese with the stronger second jump. But the second jump we saw from Brume, 30 centimetres shy of her opener, and then a no jump. So is she going to get back into form now? She's not bettered her opener.
Well, the legs went sailing over that 7 metre graphic line on the pit, the white line. But then, of course, you've got to be able to get forward out of the pit with the rest of your body. So if you go back, you suffer the consequences. 6.88 from Brume, and it's enough now to put her into first position because of the countback.
Well, that's interesting, isn't it? You think initial disappointment that she's not lengthened that opener, but in that unusual situation when you do have two on the exact same score, it's played to her advantage and put the pressure back on Brittney Reese, who's up next.
And I've got a feeling that Reese will, that's just the sort of stimulation that she'll need now. So we'll have that relaxed style on the runway, but when she gets the takeoff, I think Brittney Reese is going to explode on this one. I have a premonition.
Well, I do feel like we're still just waiting for something special to be thrown at this long jump competition. 6.97. Are we going to see the first 7 metre jump here? Brittney Reese, so cool and collected. Well, she's not improved on her earlier performance. And I think she could tell as soon as she took off with that one.
Just seemed to sort of tighten up in the air almost. It like it was melancholy on the runway. And then it was explosion at foot takeoff and then tightness instead of just staying nice and loose. 6.87, that's just 1 centimetre less than Brume
stays
did
at the top. I mean, just so close to see these two. I mean, doing the same longest jump and just 1 centimetre difference on their second longest jump.
Yeah, and interestingly, you saw that Reese does this hang technique, not leg shoot as such, or the stride, you know, the bicycle kick that we've seen others achieve. So up she goes, conversion of that horizontal into the vertical, and then just hangs, waiting. And that looked like a little bit of tension. I think both in this sort of top echelons of this competition, both on 6.97, but Broome taking over with that better second jump by 1 centimetre, 6.88 to 6.87. Basically means, I think, you know, we've got two rounds left. There's going to be something happen, I think, in this competition.
It does feel like it's building. Well, we're ready for our fifth jump. And that looked a bit long for Sawyers. She's just trying to throw everything at it now. She had a strong jump earlier on, jump number two, with that 6.80. Maybe now she's just seeing if she can push it that bit further. So close to her personal best, that performance.
Yes, the Olympic Games, and you just don't want to leave anything out on the track side. You want to give absolutely everything now. And of course, in the fifth round, we'll have a bit of another shuffle. So if there's any changes in the order, then we're going to have sort of people move around the jumping order after this fifth round.
Trying to stay calm. Each jump comes around much quicker now. There's just eight in these final stages of the final. Only two jumps left for each of these athletes to decide the Olympic champion. Tara Davis still smiling. She's still been improving. Look at that. She's the only athlete to have had four jumps that have increased successively every time.
And who's to say she's not going to upset those two at the top on this jump?
Well, it's still consistent, isn't it? She might have just improved again on her performance. Can she improve once more on the final jump?
Great speed on the runway. Fantastic sprinting by the young American. And you can see she really does go for the board here. You know, stamps that left foot down, good height, sort of like a hang, not quite on the board. And it's 6.83.
Gosh, she's consistent, isn't she?
For Davis.
So consistent. Now, she'll be wondering what she can do. She knows she's in good form. She's delivered every single time. I mean, if there was a medal for consistency, Davis would have it.
She's got to hit the board. If she doesn't hit the board, then she's going to be jumping 6.80 something. If she hits the board, who's to say she doesn't go 7?
Trying to use every moment possible to stay relaxed. Stay focused. Brooke Stratton sitting in 7th. Her best Olympic result, a 6th. She's going to have to do something a bit more than that, and she's going to improve much on that 6th place finish she had back in London.
Yeah, her 4th round jump was a pretty limp squid, wasn't it? And the run-up just looked too long. But on that one, I have to say, the run-up looked very accomplished. Good speed into takeoff. And 6.62. So it won't be threatening the leaders in this competition. And that 6.83 is still her best attempt in the second round.
Well, those at the top won't be worrying about the other performances. Going through the motions maybe there for Broome, shutting out what's going on, focusing on yourself, and that will be what Beck Womanchuk is looking to do now. She's only recorded one jump, but it was an impressive 6.88. But 1 out of 4, when she does land it, she's dangerous to those top contenders.
Well, sadly, a red flag for the Ukrainian. It was definitely close to the 7-meter white line that we can see on the screen. Fouled. We're just going to have a look. She's just going to have a look at the plasticine, but I think it was pretty, just an inch into the plasticine. She's done that a couple of times today in this final. The radar's got to be adjusted, and who's to say in the last attempt that she doesn't do that adjustment and hit the board and fly past 7 metres? Be a personal best if she did, but she's looking quite capable, despite that strapping on that knee of the takeoff foot.
Spanovic sitting in that agonizing fourth position. She's only 4 centimeters off Mihambo, off the podium, with 2 jumps remaining. Again, one who's been consistent up there, but nothing out of her skin. She was the longest in qualifier, 7 meters. If she can jump that now, that would put her straight to the top. She knows she can do it. She's done it on this runway 2 days ago. Well, the run-up looked very uncomfortable. Lots of adjustments going on there.
Yeah, we'll see the slow motion replay. And whereas the early ones, she was running off the board and continuing the running style off the board late on. Here we see just a shortening at the takeoff. Just got in the wrong place, stuck it out in front of her, and she then had to battle it, almost as if there was a stop, a board was put in front of her as opposed to running off the board. The Spanovic, disappointed. She knew, you know, before she landed, she knew that things weren't lined up for her to go to 7 meters.
Well, she stays in that fourth place with just 1 jump left. It was nice to see Brittney Reese just almost showing some compassion at that jump there. You can feel that these athletes, they all compete together on the circuit. Yes, they want to be on top of that podium, but they still empathise with each other's battles to get here.
Well, they've been battling for a few years. Spanovic at 31 and Reese sort of approaching 35 years. You can just imagine they bump into each other pretty regularly throughout a season, in a normal competitive season.
Mihambo feeling like she's not quite reached her potential in her 3 clear jumps today. Sitting in the bronze medal position though. Oh.
Red flag for Mihambo, but she's getting close, isn't she? The people watching this, you could almost hear an intake of breath. Official, well, just showing Mihambo the plasticine there. We'll see that she's just in there by an inch and a half, 2 inches or so. But that will give her a no jump. But it was definitely threatening 7 meters out into the sand.
It was. But is she going to run out of time? She leaves herself with just 1 jump to bring her real A game. 6.95 on that second jump. Still her counting score that keeps her in that bronze position.
Well, it wouldn't be unheard of in the long jump, men or women, where drama takes place in the stand. Going back to 1991, Larry Powell and Carl Lewis fighting out with world records littering the pit. And I was here watching that long ago, and the stadium was absolutely alight that night. 8.95. Mike Powell took that gold for the World Championships back in 91.
Well, Ese Brume with the gold medal to defend. It's been so close between her and Brittney Reese. She's not managed to better that opening jump, and it was a red flag anyway. But such a strong start from the Nigerian, who's not quite looked back in that form since jump number one.
No, and you know, that could be a mixture of things. It could be a sort of headwind, slightly less wind than she's expecting, too much wind, whatever it might be. So, but she now, if Brittney Reese doesn't go further and go into the top spot, the Nigerian will be the last to jump with the shuffle of the pack. How exciting is that?
Well, it shows how important it becomes in getting the jumps in. Well, before this last round, not putting that added pressure onto yourself, but gosh, it is so tight, isn't it, between these two. Brittney Reese now ready for her 5th jump. Such experience, such class. Can she use that to her advantage?
you always eye over the ears watching Brittney Reese jump.
Yeah.
Always feel that it's going to be a disaster or it's going to be absolutely stunning. And now I always get the feeling she doesn't really know what's going to happen. However, she is a fantastic competitor and it wouldn't surprise me for her to put it to bed on this fifth round jump.
Oh, it looks good. She's being consistent and it could change the standings at the top even if she hasn't jumped further.
Well, I think the smile says it. I think that's incredibly close. Now, we've got a lead at of the competition at 6.97 with a backup jump of 6.88. Reese is 6.97 with a backup of 6.95. So Reese goes back into the lead on the basis that her second jump is better than the Nigerian's second jump. How close? You couldn't get close. You couldn't write the script on this one.
This is brilliant. So the lead has changed now three times, even though the highest or the longest jump distance has not changed.
That's exactly it.
I mean, it's incredible.
And long jumpers are used to this happening. And as commentators, if you've seen a few, you're used to it sort of happening. But if you're watching it, you're thinking, what the heck is going on here?
Well, it adds to this excitement. And here we go, the slight change in the final round.
Yeah, you can see Sawyer stays down in eighth and she goes first. And then Reese, who could have lost that last to jump position until that last jump, because she jumped 6.95. That gave her a better backup jump than Brume of Nigeria, who was looking as if after the fifth round that she'd be the last to jump. So actually, I don't know what all the excitement is about. It stayed the same, for goodness sake.
Well, it certainly added the excitement, doesn't it? Which is brilliant for this event. And Jasmine Sawyers rose to the occasion early on, her third final at an Olympic Games. What can she deliver now? She gave it everything on that last one, a little bit too much with the red flag. She looks pumped.
Red flag for Sawyers. She'll be disappointed with that because she feels as if she's actually got something great running on the run-up. You know, that bundle of energy is converting that nice horizontal speed at the point of takeoff. And I think she'd be genuinely very disappointed. She felt as if something was going to happen. 10 centimetres, though, into the plasticine. And Sawyers will end up in eighth spot with 6.80 in the second round.
Well, she knows she gave it her all, and that is so important for an athlete coming to the Olympic Games, leaving knowing you left everything out there.
Well, yeah, that won't kick in just yet, though, sadly. You know, the feelings of not being or not doing what you thought you were capable of doing are those feelings. I've been there a few times myself, more often than not, I have to say.
Tara Davis, one who has risen to the occasion, trying to get the crowd to rise to the occasion for her. Nervous moments with one jump remaining. Can any of these athletes do something exceptional? Brooke Stratton, 6.83, that third jump, which puts her in seventh place. She's going to need a significant improvement. She's going to move up the standings. Starting to wind up that long run up. Jump she wanted to finish off her Olympic campaign.
No, Stratton finishes with 6.83 with the aid of a 1.2 wind, but she's into the plasticine on her final jump and she'll get no recorded jump on her sixth round effort. So she'll finish in seventh place, exactly where she finished in Rio.
Well, she's been consistent. She was sixth in London, seventh, so making it through to the top eight, but just not finding that extra extra ounce that is required at this Olympic level. Well, it takes a bit of pressure off those at the top as there's nothing huge coming from lower down the rankings, but Tara Davis could be one of those that could really mix things up.
To really get this event going to the end and keeping everybody on the edge of their seat, Davis needs to put the cat amongst the pigeons.
Well, she doesn't seem to be intimidated by the Olympic stage. She's performed consistently on the last five jumps. And again, a long way off on her takeoff, and we've seen that a few times. She's got the potential there. She's come, she has given everything, and she, well, will just be coming back, I'm sure. We'll see lots more of this young athlete.
Yeah, the young American, the 22-year-old, good on the runway, just cut a stride again, gets on the board nicely, but then the undercarriage comes down too soon. Those feet shooting out, but shooting not far enough into the sand. And she records 6.71. Six jumps, though, and remarkably consistent, apart from that first one, which was 6.62, that set her up.
Well, earlier this year, Davis did jump a 7.14, so she must have come in here with high hopes. As much as she's smiling for the cameras, she, on paper, had the second longest jump of all of these athletes in 2021. Beck Romanchuk, can she do something special? Can she get the white flag on her final jump? She doesn't hold back. If it's a white flag, it could be big.
Well, she's got no choice now. She wants glory, she's got to go for it.
She went big, but she gave it too much again, and that is just one jump recorded for the Ukrainian. Like you said, she couldn't hold back, she didn't hold back, and as a result, she ended up well onto that plasticine.
Yep, and she, on reflection, will say, I was in reasonable shape. Great effort, though. I mean, it does only literally take one jump to win gold, but she didn't with 6.88. But a reasonable attempt at getting up there, and she'll finish in fifth place.
Ivana Spanovic sits on a 6.91 from her second jump, just 4 centimetres shy of Mihambo in the bronze. But this, the last attempt to mix up or to snatch away a medal from the top three. I reckon Reese is taking a look under those shades.
Shortens a stride into the takeoff, and you just knew then that the chance had gone to go long. It's a reasonable jump in the circumstances, but you just tighten up the takeoff tackle, if you like. Those, you know, the takeoff foot needs to go in and be in exactly the right position, and she knows it. She sort of shrugs, walks away. 6.72, not a bad jump, but one that you could have started with and then built on. Spanovic, the longest qualifier at 7 meters, that would have won today on the board, but she had to compromise the takeoff by just cutting the stride down. And you can see the over-rotation in the air. And as soon as you get the head and shoulders above the hip, in front of the hips, the legs can't go anywhere. They rotate downwards, so you come back on themselves.
Well, this, the final jump for the reigning world champion, Malaika Mihambo. She hasn't quite found her form this year. She's got a personal best of 7.30. But 6.98, her season's best, was in this Olympic stadium 2 days ago. She needs more than that right now.
She needs that, and you've just watched the body language of the other two, you know. Reese in gold medal position on countback. Brume turning away. They can't watch. Mihambo, this is your moment, or is it not? Good speed.
Well, there's gasps from the crowd. We are going to have to wait with bated breath for that to be measured. I think she doesn't know either. She knows it was good.
Well, we could have somebody getting the magic figure of seven appear on the scoreboard. And if it does, then we have a new leader. And claps, we have
seven meters. Well, that's our first seven of the session, of the final. And when it counts, Malaika Mihambo delivering on her sixth and final jump with a season's best.
Let's look at this. Great speed. Those arms acting like being on a puppet string, but the bottom half of her body is functioning. She's not really got on the board, so 19 centimeters short. Just add 10, and that's a 7.10 jump. That perhaps would have put it out of reach of everybody else. Now, she can't quite believe it, but I think on reflection she will, because she's in good shape. Now, 3 centimeters determines where the medals go now.
Well, Ese Brume has been on the top spot, battling it with Brittney Reese back and forth, but she now finds herself in the bronze medal position unless she can better 6.97. Well, it looks as though it wasn't quite enough for the Nigerian.
Gets the white flag, but she knows she got her legs out in front, but then her shoulder came back into the sand. And that looks like it's not quite good enough. 6.90. So Broome, who led earlier on in the competition on countback, ends up in the sixth round taking the bronze medal. They can't take that off her. She compromised that speed on the runway by cutting down on her stride. Look, two out. She got out of that, to her credit, nicely on the board. Good height at takeoff, but just that shoulder touching the sand at 6.90.
Well, she needed a 6.95 or more to equal Brittney Reese. So Brittney Reese guaranteed a silver with that 6.97, but can she ruin the day for Mihambo, who can hardly watch through her fingers?
Well, Brittney Reese, the 34-year-old, probably came out today thinking, yeah, this is a nice day for a mature lady like me to come out and join in a bit of jumping here. Now, she's got the experience, she's got the tools. What can she do? She's silver currently. Well, we can see what's happened. The leg shoot went out past that graphic at seven. Nervous weight all around, but it does look as if the sand has been broken by her shoulders.
Well, the camera's now flicking between these two. Brittney Reese wins the silver medal. And it is Malaika Mihambo who becomes the Olympic champion with that final jump. We said it would be a 7 meter jump. It was bang on 7 meters. Malaika Mihambo, the world champion, is now the Olympic champion.
Fourth in Rio. The American got the silver in Rio. She won gold in London. She picks up another medal in this long jump, this event, which is fantastic to watch. And you move from one position to another. It's fluid. And then in the last round, just like in the men's competition, the winner does it, nails the last jump. And in this case, 7 meters takes gold medal for Mihambo of Germany.
Well, what an exciting final round that was. We said it was building up, didn't we? And what a delivery by the world champion, Malaika Mihambo. She'd been consistent. She did a 6.95 on her second jump that put her in a medal position where she didn't move off the podium. And what consistency by this American. 3 Olympic Games, 3 Olympic medals. A gold, a silver, and now another silver to add to it.
And who's to say the way she goes about her business that she won't be back in 3 years' time in Paris? But we'll wait for that to happen. Reese displaying fantastic characteristics and using her experience to win that medal. Broome getting quite emotional. She was in gold. then she was in silver on countback, and then she ends up with bronze. I mean, all in the space of a blink of an eye.
Oh, the emotions, the tension in this game that is the long jump. A lovely congratulations from Jasmine Sawyers, who made it into the top eight again at an Olympic Games. Well, she kept us on the edge of our seats, didn't she, throughout that event, and delivered at the very last moment.
Well, you watch the competition unfold and you just see things happening, and you just think Mihambo, she's a tall athlete, got long lower limbs. If she can just get her foot on that takeoff in the position where she's comfortable to explode off it, and there you go, in the last round, she got it not absolutely perfectly right, but it was enough to take gold.
Well, a season's best. I mean, we'd said that Mihambo had that potential. The eyes were on her. She did a season's best in the qualifying with a 6.98. She didn't quite manage to get that until that final jump. And she has jumped 7.30. So the only athlete to jump a 7-meter and claiming the gold by just 3 centimeters. Well, she can certainly jump, can't she? And now with the flag in her arms, she'll be doing plenty more jumping. That concludes it. The Olympic champion, Malaika Mihambo, with the 7-meter jump at the last. Brittney Reese, a 6.97, taking the silver on countback after Ese Brume from Nigeria with that very emotional bronze. She clung in there after a very hard-fought final. That was exciting. The women's long jump final.
Lavella Mings, made of hard stuff, though, the Frenchman. You don't get to be 34 years of age and continuing to compete at this level by being soft, that's for sure.
Well, one thing Renaud Lavillenie has got is longevity. And that was certainly in evidence with some of the more experienced women who contested a thoroughly absorbing long jump final. All unfolding in the lead up to the men's 400 hurdles showdown. It was a truly fantastic final. And it was one of those, John, where you got to the last round and such was the quality of the lineup and such was the tight amounts of space between one and eight, any one of the eight women could have taken it. It went right down to the wire.
We had swirling winds. We had positive, we had sort of slightly negative winds going on in that part of the stadium. And as you suggest, Rob, it just started, had every opportunity to be a classic, and it turned into just that, with people swapping positions on that leaderboard. And I have to say, for the field events, and stand up for the field events, you know, winning in the last round on the sixth attempt does happen. It can happen. It's more likely to happen if the way that events in the field are left to six attempts for the best eight competitors.
And it happened in both of the long jumps, the men's and the women's. Sixth round attempt, come to from behind and claim gold.
Bronze medalist Nigeria.
Gold medalist Nigeria.
Ese Brume.
So we have the bronze medalist. An interesting stat, we had seven of the women compete in the final eight in Rio, and those same seven turned up again in the eight in Tokyo. What a statistic for the statisticians that is. And Brume of Nigeria, she was fifth in Rio, and she's got up the board and she won bronze. And at one stage, she was leading on countback coming into the fourth and fifth rounds and ended up with bronze. That's what this competition is all about. And then we had, from the USA, Brittney Reese. What a performance. Silver in Rio, gold in London. She got the silver in Rio, and she's got the silver again in Tokyo 2020. 6.97 meters. And she got that medal on countback from Brume of Nigeria, where Brume had 6.88 backing up her 6.97, and Reese had 6.95, which she jumped in the fifth round, backing that 6.97 up. And then to snaffle them all in the last round, like a crocodile out there picking out the balls and the little frogs as they're going around to fill their tummies. This young lady, Mihambo of Germany, she was lying back in third place. She was actually fourth in Rio, and in the last round that she popped out to 7 meters, season's best, with very little wind assistance whatsoever, and she took the gold medal. A fantastic performance from the German. And to say she was happy is a total understatement.
Ladies and gentlemen, the anthem of Germany.
Fourth in Rio, gold in Tokyo. The 27-year-old matures like a good wine and takes it home to Germany.
And never before has an Olympic commentator managed to get an analogy about crocodiles and frogs into a medal presentation.
It's working next to you. I become inspirational. I can't control myself here.